consider different areas of policy, how it might affect MaaS. We're now moving straight on to how MaaS is being innovated within the transport sector already. So we're going to hear some technologies that may well rise up and be key to what's going to happen with MaaS in the next 2, 3, 4, 5 years. Who knows how fast it's going to travel? First, please would you welcome John Bickerton. John Bickerton is the Chief Engineer for Reading Buses, responsible for 60 staff and operating 181 vehicles, including 31 hybrid double decks and 35 compressed natural gas vehicles. John graduated from the University of Bath and in automotive engineering and is a chartered member of the Institute of Mechanical Engineers, Institution of Mechanical Engineers, and chair of their automobile section. Welcome, John.
Thank you for that terrifying small amount of fall. My name is John Bickerton. I'm Chief Engineer for Reading Buses. I'm going to start by telling you a story. I started working in the bus industry straight out of university probably a number of years ago, and I worked for a transport company in the Southwest who were having a problem because they published a booklet full of timetables to tell people where the buses go and where. But they're quite expensive to produce, and people were taking them, and the company was broadly incensed that using all of this information that they were publishing when it looked really pretty on bookshelves. They couldn't keep bookshelves full. They had brilliant ideas, they put a PP on the front of it, and sometimes they charged people for it, and sometimes they gave them a discount that sold them £20. Now, bus usership was declining, so people didn't necessarily know where the buses went and when, but at least they were making money from their advertising. Now, I'm not sure of another company who has managed to monetize their own advertising stream, and I can't work out whether it was genius or whether it was an absolute retrograde step in terms of not telling people where and when the buses run, because that's a secret. God forbid we tell them how much they cost, but certainly telling them where and when they run, we ought to charge them for that information. I can't understand if that's genius or not. I'm pleased to say the world has moved on a little, and I hope that Reading buses are at the vanguard of further. So what have we got next? Right, who we are and what we do. We run a bus network in Reading. I'm pleased to say, since I wrote my introduction, we've grown. We're now 191 buses, not 182. We are growing 8% year on year in terms of passenger numbers. We've had them for 5 years. And we are currently bus operator of the year. So I think whatever we're doing it right for the bus sector. The question is, what does that look like in the future and what's next? So, we provide lots of nice stuff for our buses. Key amongst those in terms of delivering for our customers, we're finding, is providing Wi-Fi and providing USB charging for mobile phones. Both of those are key enablers for mobility as a service, because without connectivity and without battery, you can't use your mobile device. It's not yet lunchtime, mine's on charge at the back, because I don't think I'm going to get through the day, and I come here mostly by car and train. So battery use is going to be a huge part of that mix. If you're providing infrastructure, providing vehicles, are going to have to react to that. We have a special offer for young travellers where we offer them a discounted fare, as most bus operators do. We don't ask for any ID. If you say you're under 19, you are under 19. Unless you turn up, you've got a bit longer than mine and you can see you're graying a bit around the corners. Then we will start the challenge, but we don't ask you to fill in a form, write off to us, get an ID card, it comes back, both of us look like you. We don't do that, and that's grown, not abstractly, but grown our youth market aggressively. Those people are the people who are on pay-as-you-go data contracts, who connect to Wi-Fi and Starbucks, who will take a journey on a bus to charge their phone. And we're seeing evidence for people to do that. I don't care why they're giving me their money, as long as they're giving their money to get on the bus, they're traveling. We're doing all the other good stuff on there as well. I said we're recognised as being pretty good at what we do, and I hope that continues to be true. But that means we need to innovate, and that means inevitably we need to change. We're adapting what we do. So 30 years ago, the idea of providing individual seats for bus passengers rather than a bench was innovative. I'm pleased to say that's not innovative anymore, and most operators have cottoned onto that and are doing that. Wheelchair accessibility came in and became a very important part of our industry, and that change, albeit probably a 15-year programme, is now nearly complete to say every bus in the UK will be wheelchair accessible, certainly by January next year, apart from New York Code Services. And the government and people like them as well, and we've won lots of awards down the bottom right. So, bus operating model, when I started in the industry, was give people a timetable, find a bus, take some money off them. If you were a really innovative operator, you had a smart car system, so you took money off them before they got on board. Otherwise, you take money off them at this point, at which point you've got their money, and it doesn't matter if you run on time or not, or your bus leaks. You take the money going, and they fall off that end of the map. And if you were really, really good at what you're doing, they'd come back around and do the whole thing again the next day. We hope. Outside of London, the bus industry is deregulated, so anybody can turn up into Reading and compete with my bus services if you have an operator's license, I think it's a passenger carrying vehicles. So there is no kind of customer loyalty in that process. The only reason that we don't have a maelstrom of everybody running lots and lots of buses is it's quite a low margin industry. I do wonder sometimes why we're doing it at all. So in a more modern world, we're a little bit smarter about how we do what we do. We've got different ways of getting money off people, and we've got different ways of giving them information. And that is probably a state-of-the-art bus operation today. So we launched our mobile phone app, which I think is the first bus journey planner and ability to pay for your journey app in one piece. I think we're the first with that. We launched that 3 weeks ago. 2016, not in 2000 when Facebook started to be a thing. It's taken the industry 16 years to deliver that. I'm kind of pleased, kind of ashamed to say we're the first. We've got a smart card system and we're pretty good at giving people timetables and booklets, which we don't charge for, I'm pleased to say. But what does that look like in a connected world? So I think the next stage that we will begin to harness and use is to take data back in the other direction and learn about our customers, learn about journey patterns, not just how many people are on a particular bus, although we're working on that, but when do those customers recur, where do they travel from, where do they travel to, and starting to get that information. And that begins to speak about mobility as a service. The question next from that is, who owns that data? That's my data. That is my industrial intelligence, which allows me to understand my customer base and make money from them. Or do I see that as an opportunity to make that open source, throw it out to other people, and then use that, crossing my fingers, that means more people will come and use my bus. So in terms of what we're doing, it's working very well. We're growing year on year, and we're growing quite aggressively. That's not reflected amongst all of us operators in the UK. I hope it's because we're doing the right thing. Certainly Reading is growing. We have very strong green credentials, we run a fleet of hybrids, we run a growing fleet of gas buses. But I'd like to think and I hope that a lot of it is because we're offering the right thing to our customers. Clean, reliable, punctual buses, they're accessible, they're easy to use, and we're finding different ways of allowing people to pay in order that it becomes a network. And after walking, we are the second highest mode to get into the centre of Reading. That includes the fact that we're on the roadways of the main line and we're the first stop after Paddington. So all of our routes are growing, that's nice. There are some areas where we have done particularly special things and grown aggressively because of it. The Claret route goes through the university, and so we refurbished some buses for the university and put in a lounge with snakeskin seats, a jukebox, some tables, an iPad, some Lego, a bookshelf, carpet, Wi-Fi, USB charging, and wheelchair accessibility. And we saw 17% growth overnight of running on the same route with the same fares and the same frequency. But that's a bit special because they're university students, most of them are drunk, but they're fairly intelligent people. And so they don't smash up a bus that's got a jukebox that we bought off Amazon for £45. Which is, I think in this photo it's tucked up in the corner, but there's a reflection of me on the panel. That works in that market, but how do we take that and carry it to the next stage in terms of stage carriage work? That's not what I thought was going to happen next. There's lots of pressures within Reading, and we're seeing the declining car usage, which is what some of that's talking about, particularly for the youth market, where we're seeing fewer and fewer people, including some of our own younger employees, who don't have a car license. It's very expensive to get a car license, it's then very expensive to get a car, it's then very expensive to tax, insure, and take a car, and then you've got to put petrol in it, and that's not particularly cheap either. And for £4 a day, we'll take you around Reading for free. Yeah. So with that soundbite, car usage is declining. And we offer a genuine alternative to it. To the point that car dealership in Reading is going out of business, which I'm kind of pleased about. And I'm kind of not, because the people who work there need to get there and hopefully travel by bus. I'm a deeply selfish person, really. However, there's more going on with Green Journeys, for example, a producer report talking about the impact of congestion. When the town becomes more congested, I can either add more buses in and provide the same frequency with more buses to increase my costs. Increase my costs, I have to increase my fares because we don't make a good margin. Candidly, our margin is between 2 and 5%. Most bus operators aim at 10% on a good day, and that's their target. And then people shout at each other because budgets don't happen the way that Excel tells you they will. The other option is to reduce the frequency, and that again has an impact on making buses less accessible. Because a bus, 10 or 15 minutes between vehicles, you don't go and look at the timetable. When the bus runs every half hour, every hour, you need to look in your pocket to work out when it runs. So both of those challenge, and in terms of congestion, they add a challenge to our business in countering passenger growth, or speeding decline in many cases. Mobility as a service offers an alternative to that. We can be running Uber cars around, or we can be running driverless cars around, as everyone tells me is definitely going to happen. And utopia would be that I can just press a button, wave my hand in the air, and I get taken where I'm going, fast, cheap, ideally free at the point of use. We go straight to where we're going. The danger is on the other side, that there's a load of these cars running around empty in a massive congested city, and nobody can actually get anywhere, despite the fact I can put 90 people in a small piece of road space and move them along. So in terms of the next stage of bus travel, we published our Future Forward document a few months ago now. I'm going to really quickly flip through the six areas of that document, which are on the screen there. So the first one is about personalising the experience. Retail has got this sus. We still say hello to people if we've got a really well-trained driver. So we can personalise that and do some exciting things for them. Changing the way the vehicle looks on board, we started that with our university buses, we're driving it on with our new buses that will be launched next week for our Woodley route, with a sofa on board, with an iPad on board, for a normal service bus, and that, we hope, will generate growth. Guided driving, why, when we're reversing buses, do we sit the driver 12 metres away from what he's about to hit and face in the other direction, with no level of intelligence in the vehicle, and then allow him to reverse into things? There is more we can do in terms of building vehicle safety. When I ask for emergency autonomous braking in buses, which is mandatory in the truck sector, I get told it's not legal in buses, and anyway, you don't want it because you've got standing passengers. They'll fall over. Going to fall over when we hit things. Buses will be connecting to other bits of infrastructure, whether it's on-bus systems, whether it's the bus stops, whether it's other pieces of infrastructure like traffic lights. Maintenance and support, our buses never break down, but when they do, we need to get stuff to them, we want to understand that. We can go proactive and start to understand what's wrong with it before it breaks down and start to predict that. And finally, we will always be working with people and in partnership. And I've got a little video to show you about technology. So we looked at a demand, some of you have seen the sensors during the coffee break. Developing a sensor, put into a seat very, very cheaply, less than £2 a seat, to allow us to see if people are sitting there. And we can then, TfL can do that for a huge amount of money, whereas we think we can do it and then broadcast that information to bus stops and also onto the bus. And then as the bus goes along, you'll see on your mobile app that the seat occupancy is changing. If you want a particular seat, you'll be able to wait 3 minutes for a bus that's got it available, for example, if you like sitting upstairs, top deck on the right, and you're driving. We demoed this at our open day last year, and I'm going to really cross my fingers and this plays in a very, very short video.
1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 3.
I'll send all you to can't count to 4 if you turn it out.
3, 1, 2, 4, 3, all together. All together.
Now, we won't have it be like a supermarket checkout, but what we will do is be information onto a web-facing server and allow other people to do stuff with that data, because I'm not a web developer, I'm a bus operator, I don't even mind ticket machines. The idea of producing web apps isn't me, but I can put stuff on an API to allow other people to use it. Finally, this is one of our beautiful new buses that will launch next week. Really, really proud of those, because I think they have a spec that will draw people to keep using buses. We have mobility as a service in Reading, that's what we do. We don't link it with other cars, and I wonder whether bus operators will see that as a threat, or whether they'll see it as an opportunity. In terms of levels of technology, developing the seat sensors in-house and in partnership with another company called ECH Engineering, we can reach up that value chain and back towards our customers and start to provide different levels of that ability. Some of it I'm not interested in, some of it I am. I put the old photo of me up there because it saves embarrassing Lizzie and Will, who's in the back, stand up, I'm going to embarrass you anyways. If you speak with these two lovely people, they will show you the sensors that we've got together. It's not massively technical, it hasn't cost us a lot of money, but it appears to be very, very innovative as far as the bus sector is concerned. Thank you very much.